about canine structure and performance and injuries and sports medicine and stuff like that. No, I will not sell it to anybody else. You can always unsubscribe. But they'll be starting to come out next month, just all the newest data. So if you're interested, please sign your email name up. I'm not allowed to, the laws in the United States government say I have to get your permission. So by signing this, I guess I'm getting your permission to do that. Because we didn't know how many people were coming, but if you didn't get a handout, when you put your email name, email address down, put H next to it. And if you do, I will email. We'll email you a PDF. Okay. So if you want that, it'll go out to you tomorrow. Right, Mary Beth. Okay. So that's great. So today I'm going to talk to you about a whole bunch of things, but I'm not going to take very long over each item. I'm going to kind of give you the big overall picture. I realize that probably many of you are not conformation people, per se. Maybe you don't show your dog in conformation. I know I don't show my dog in conformation for many reasons, which I won't go into. And this is Hobby, my demo dog. The thing is that I think that teaching our dogs to stack is very, very important because I want to take a photograph of my dog every year. I take a photograph of him when he's 8 weeks of age, and then I take a photograph with the same background and hopefully with the same person stacking him if possible. It's a dog to fill out that same thing. The scale would look like this: 0000006789010. They would not admit it until it was at 6. And by the time it's at 6, it's pretty significant. So the thing that I've been doing recently is showing people some hints that they can use to discover that their dog has a problem long before it has a problem. Let me give you another example. About 2 years ago, I looked at a golden retriever. I was traveling across Canada and the U.S. in my RV, and a person who owns a dog from the same breeder as me contacted me, and she said, I'd like you to look at my dog. Tried to retrain the weeds for 4 years. I'm here to tell you, if you guys do agility, if your dog has a performance problem, always check for an injury, not a training issue first. You can always fix a training issue if that's what it is, but you sure can't fix an injury from training it differently, can you? And it was kind of sad because this dog lost the majority of her adult career from the time she was 5 until she was 9. They were trying to fix this weed pole problem, when all along it was a soft tissue injury of the right front. So always, always, always ask yourself first, any change in behavior, any change in performance, ask yourself, is it an injury? And always get that checked out first. Now you may have an issue sometimes finding a veterinarian who can identify those things. I would say to you, persist in finding veterinarians who work with athletes, okay? And also persist in finding a veterinarian who will listen to you, because really, no one knows your dog like you do. And never say to yourself, oh, I'm probably just imagining it. Never say that, because who's going to imagine an injury? I'm not going to imagine it, unless I had Munchausen syndrome by proxy or something. I'm not going to imagine an injury. No one wants an injury for their dog, right? So you saw something, because nobody knows your dog as well as you do, okay? So that's what I wanted to say, and I guess I really encourage you to train your dogs to stack from the time they're really, really young, and just as was going to use him as a demo dog. He decides to lie down. So the most important things about the dog's position when they're stacked are these three things. And just do it in front of a mirror and practice. And honestly, it's not that difficult to get the dog to do it. So you're going to stand. Stand. So the three things that you want are, and by the way, the other thing that I notice is a lot of people don't know how to move their dog to get them into position. So I'm just going to briefly show you that. You want the collar up behind the dog's ears, because if you control the dog's head, you control their weight. Okay? And I'm actually going to do this on the ground because he's too tall for me. Okay. So you control their head, you control their weight. Turn around. So the first thing you do is you always move the front leg by holding the elbow. Okay? You don't grab it like this, which I see a lot of people doing. I even see veterinarians doing that. Don't do that. You have a lot of control over the dog if you position them by the elbow. And then you switch hands, you offload by moving the dog's head to the side, you offload this leg, and it's nice and easy to move. Okay? When you're moving the rear, again, you're holding the leg. When you're moving the rear, you hold it by the hock, okay? And you place the dog's foot nice and gently in the correct position. He's leaning on me, so I'm gonna unlean him. Okay, and then the head is straight. Now, what you want to have is radius and ulna perpendicular to the ground, the rear pastern, which is from the hock to the foot, perpendicular to the ground, and the head up and looking straight ahead. If you have that position, take the photograph, and take a photograph every year like that. And you can actually print it up, and you can draw lines on that photograph. Just like I'm going to show you three rules of thumb for evaluating your dog. And you can actually draw lines on the photograph and you compare them from last year to this year. It's tremendously valuable. Why does a dog generally straighten its legs when it's injured? Because it takes musculature to hold the dog's leg in angulation. So if the dog is standing like this, the muscles are holding the dog's leg. I'm getting a cramp in my foot. I have to use that. That shows how good my musculature is, right? The dog needs muscles to hold. He needs the core. He needs the muscles that hold the hip in place. He needs these muscles, the quads and the hamstrings, quads and hamstrings. He needs all those muscles to be able to hold himself in position. But let's say you have a puppy and he had rear angulation that looked like this, okay? But as he developed, he had hip dysplasia, okay? But you didn't recognize it. There's a lot of things you can do. Hip dysplasia is not a very big deal, well, unless it's really severe. And you didn't recognize it. And then, as I found with a friend of mine, Hobby, lie down. At age 9, the dog's rear looked like this. Why do you think the dog would do that? Well, it was actually like this. Because here's what happens. If you have pain in your hip, you're not going to use your leg as much. So you get muscle atrophy. Now you can't hold the leg in the angled position because the muscles aren't strong enough to hold it there down. And so what you end up doing is stacking the leg one on top of the bones, one on top of the other. So now the bones support your weight. You don't have to use the muscles. A lot of these dogs, you'll see that what happens with them is, stand up, stand, is that, just imagine he's got, so look at his rear, you imagine that he has that amount of angulation, but if you then, for example, really straighten his rear up, his butt would come up. Sorry, that didn't mean great. His butt would come up. So now he would be higher in the rear than he was before. Okay? Down. Lie down. So look for those changes. You can see things way early, all right? Look for things like your dog facing you. Does one of his feet turn out? It didn't before. You got the photographs. By the way, you're not just going to take photographs of the side view, but also the dog standing front view and rear view, okay? So watch those, because a lot of dogs with injuries, the first thing you'll see, especially injuries of the soft tissue of the shoulder, first thing you'll see is the dog will turn that foot out a little bit, protecting these soft tissues. Now, let me tell you, Studies of injuries in dogs are pretty rare, but there are three studies in which they've looked at the injuries in agility dogs, which is a pretty, it's a pretty active game with a lot of different movements. Probably not going to be very different from dogs that do a lot of field. Probably comparable to that. Did you know, this is really interesting, in the past we used to think about dogs orthopedically as bone problems, right? Hip dysplasia, OCD, panosteitis, things like arthritis, okay, things like that. Did you know that 87% of the injuries in those dogs were soft tissue, not bone? 87%. So that changes our whole point of view from looking at bone-oriented things to looking at soft tissue-oriented things. And to be able to do that, you have to have a veterinarian who knows those techniques. So keep looking. You know, when I moved from Canada to the United States 30 years ago, it took me 10 years to find a physician who would listen to me, treat me like a human being, not like some stupid person who didn't know anything. And you should not be treated that way by any of your health professionals, including the veterinarian, because you're part of the healthcare team, are you not? Okay? They're out there. Find those ones who will communicate with you, who will listen to you, who will trust your opinion and at least follow through to see if the things that you see might be true, and who knows how to diagnose soft tissue injuries, because those are the big ones, all right? And those ones are the ones that show up in a modification of how your dog is stacked. It really shows up quite early in that. You look at those photographs carefully, okay? And you can't see everything on a photograph. I don't know if you can see this, but it's a bearded collie and a wet bearded collie.
Oh, yeah, that was cool.
You know, sometimes you just have to feel underneath the fur, and certainly that's true of our Goldens. You can't tell everything by photograph. Now, you could take a photograph of the dog soaked up. Wet isn't good enough, because once your dog shakes, the hair is all over the place. But if you soap them up, and the coat all sticks down, you can see a lot of things. I think we should do the CCA evaluations with our dogs soaped up. Yeah. Do you think that would make a lot more sense? Yeah. Or you could feel them and be experienced as our judges are. Lie down. Okay, so the other thing is, become familiar with proportions. If you can see this picture of these two puppies, I'm not sure if they're Labs or Goldens. I think they're Goldens. Maybe one's a Lab and one's a Golden. You see the circles that I've drawn? A circle around the upper body in the front and a circle around the upper body in the rear. Those circles should be the same size. Now, if I saw that puppy that's on the left, the first thing I did was I said, whoa, there's something wrong here. That dog is out of proportion. He's got too big a front and too small a rear. Can you see that? So look at that. Think about that. Deb, can Jan get your dogs out for us?
Probably not.
Can we have someone else hold the video camera that's fairly experienced at videoing? Thank you. So the next thing that I want you to do all the time with your dogs is feel their fitness. It's not something we're used to doing, and I think it's really, really important. You got to look at your dog in a certain way. You got to feel their muscle sizes, okay? Now let me show you the six muscles that I feel. You can just get them out and then just hold them back there for a second while I show them. Okay, stand up. Get out Dash first. So, and we'll give you a chance to feel dogs and all of your own dogs as well, but I'm just kind of giving you a quick summary first. There's six muscles you want to feel, okay? You just want to put your hand here on the shoulder muscles. This is the scapula. Just feel the size of the muscles there. Feel the size of these muscles on the back. Okay? Press in the lateral abdominal and the ventral abdominal muscles. Feel how firm they are. What you're feeling for is how firm they are and how large they are. So that's one, two, three, four, and then the quads, five, the hamstrings, six. Those six muscle groups can give you a lot of information. Okay? What you're going to feel, by the way, the only two muscles that don't get bigger, they only get firmer, are the lateral and the ventral abdominals. All the other ones can get bigger and firmer. Down. Now, what I want is these paraspinal muscles right here. You know how you have a dorsal vertebral spine? I want those muscles to be rounded like this when I feel them come off the spine. So they're going to look like that. If they're flat, the dog is not properly conditioned. If they're really flat and angled like that, the dog has actual atrophy, and you'll feel that in older dogs, right, from disuse. Did you know that your dog doesn't have to have, when it's older, it doesn't have to lose muscle? It really doesn't. My last golden retriever before him was 15 and a half on the day that she died. She was giving a demonstration for the University of Pennsylvania Veterinary School's Working Dog Center. She was demonstrating how she could do a bag, then go up onto her hind legs in a stand, and then go back down into a bag three times without putting her front feet down. This was at 15 and a half. And I am not joshing you. Actually, she got her CCA at 14 years and 9 months of age, and she looked in as good condition as he is. They don't have to get weak in the rear. How many dogs have you known that got weak in the rear or the core and had to be euthanized because they just couldn't get around anymore? No. I'm telling you, that doesn't have to happen. It's not arthritis. I used to think it was arthritis, and then I did a bunch of postmortems on dogs, and they didn't have any arthritis at all. They just had weakness. And then I noticed, so she did the bag stand bag perfectly fine, but then I noticed she had a little bit of a moist cough. So we were already at the vet school. I just went down to the clinic, and we realized that she had metastatic hemangiosarcoma in her lungs, and I euthanized her that day. But she was in perfect fitness, and that's what every one of your dogs can be. And 15 and a half, you know what? You have to die of something. So I was okay with that. So take those photos and feel your dogs. Now, bring Dash over here. Bobby, come on, put your feet up, or else. So I want you, afterwards, when we're going to feel dog's muscles, first of all, see the way he has less coat than Hobby, and it's less curly too, so you can really see the way there's the dorsal spinous processes. See how it comes out rounded? That's what you want for good back muscles. Now I'll tell you what, a lot of dogs have back injuries. Second to shoulders, back injuries come next, okay? The other thing I want you to feel on this dog, how old is he now? So he's 8 and a half. I want you to feel the size and firmness of his leg muscles. These are the quads. These are the hamstrings back here. I don't know if you can see this bulge. Can you see that bulge? That's how, you know, you should see those bulges. You should see definition between muscle groups. Look at that bulge there. And if you feel on the inside of his leg right here, you can feel something the size of an egg, or a little bit bigger than a chicken egg, like maybe a duck egg. That's also an indication of real strong hamstrings. Right in here, beside the tail, right behind the scrotum, okay? Or vulva, I guess, whichever. So, but look at that, see that definition there? Yeah. That's what you want. Look at this indentation here, okay? So he has really nice quads and hamstrings, and they're balanced. Now she's gonna bring out, or a friend of hers is gonna bring out, I need you to hold two dogs in your hand. Her younger dog, and what you'll feel is her younger dog has these massive quads, the biggest quads you'll ever feel. Hamstrings, not so much. They're there, they're strong, but they're not matching the quads, okay? And what you want is you want the size and strength of these muscles to match each other, okay? The other thing that I've noticed is sometimes I'll feel a dog and I'll feel their shoulder muscles and I'm like, whoa, this dog feels like Arnold Schwarzenegger. He's got massively big shoulder muscles. A bell should go off in your head. Why does he have such big shoulder muscles? In general, the dogs with massively big shoulder muscles are taking weight off of the rear. There's something going on in the rear, and they're leaning themselves forward. So watch for that as well, and we're going to give you a chance to feel your dogs, and I'll come around and help you evaluate them also, okay? This is tremendously important because we can direct our exercise to dogs to target the specific muscles that they need to work on. Your dog has a weak front, we can give exercises like having the dog wave or doing wheelbarrowing where we lift the dog's rear and we have them walk on their fronts up a set of stairs, or lots of other exercises where we're just targeting the front. There's other exercises like the bag that target the core. You can do the bag on hills, and whatever muscles are facing up the hill are going to be worked more. exercises that work the rear, especially running up hills and jumping into ponds and jumping over jumps work the rears. So you want to work what the dog needs. If your dog already has massively big front leg muscles, you don't need to work on that. Just maintain. So that's important to know. And I'm always evaluating my dog's fitness level. Okay, so I'm going to give you three rules of thumb for evaluating your dog's structure. Then we'll break up into groups and you can try it out and you can evaluate your dog's fitness and structure. Oh, one more thing I want to mention about keeping your dog fit. Very, very important. When you're trying to build strength, you want to work the dog's muscles to overload, right? So I was on a cruise last week, I'm in the gym, I'm doing the biceps curls, got 15 pounds, I can do that, go up to 17 and a half pounds, it's a little bit harder, go up to 20 pounds and I can do three and then I'm like this and I can't do it. Now I have actually been building my biceps, okay? If I was just gonna do the 15 pounds and I'm going like this, not building anything. So there's that concept of working the muscle to overload. Very important for you to think of. Now, let me make a point here. If your dog's main exercise is going out in the yard and retrieving till he's tired, it's a bad, bad thing. That's a good way to get a dog injured. Because when you're asking the dog to do something that their brain tells them they really, really want to do, it's gonna bypass their normal sense they would have, okay? And I will tell you, honestly, I almost killed him 2 years ago. And I'm going to tell you what the story was. I was in Washington, and I was in Washington State, and I was with a friend who had three best in show dogs. And she took me to this place where there's a river, and there's a really strong current, and about 200 yards down the river, there's a great big dam. So we take a bucket of balls, and we're throwing the balls up the river so the dog has to swim up the river to get the balls. And after about 15 or 20 retrieves, her dogs came out of the water and they didn't want to go in anymore. And I'm thinking to myself, those best in show dogs, no stamina. You know, in my mind, I'm thinking not very nice things. This is the wrong thing because guess what? I threw the ball five more times and he came out on the shore and collapsed. And honestly, it was 5 minutes before he could stand up. He has no off switch where retrieving is concerned. And I didn't know that until that day. And honestly, if I'd thrown one more dog, I think he would have gone down the dam. Because he had nothing left in him. The best in show dogs were smarter than that. They said, I'm tired and I'm not going to do it. Okay? So running your dog to exhaustion is not the way to build muscle. It really is not. Not only that, you can't target the specific muscles that the dog needs, right? You're working all the muscles equally, generally. So don't do that. Okay, I'm going to go over three rules of thumb and then we're going to break up into groups and try out our dogs. These are very simplistic ways to look at dog structure. It's much more complex than that and it really does take a lifetime to learn. But I'm going to show it to you, these simple things that are three rules of thumb that are just a starter. Okay, just a way to get started. Now, the easiest thing to evaluate is rear angulation. It's much easier than the front, so I'm going to start with the rear. Remember that the dog needs to be standing so that the okay, so it's right there next to the base of the tail. The long, and you might have to brush your dog's feathers aside. The longer the distance is between those two lines, the more rear angulation the dog has. Okay? Now, I just learned today in the CCA evaluation a little tip which I never knew before. I'm going to tell you that. And that is, if you draw a line down the back, this is for Goldens only, and maybe other breeds, but I only know about Goldens. Probably stand still. Is there someone who could stand up and just hold it here? Thanks, Kathy. So I can, I don't have to do all this. Okay, so here's the tip I learned today. That's why I did the CCA. When you draw a line down the back of the dog's hamstrings here, that line continuing down should come to the dog's toe. Okay, so, see that? Mm-hmm. they should form a line. So that's for Goldens. I never knew that before. I can't remember which person it was that told me that. It was one of you two. Anyway. So if you can recall in your mind, here's a Golden Retriever. Here's a Sharpei. Here's an Irish Setter. Here's a German Shepherd. Okay? So a German Shepherd has so much angulation they have to stand in this way just to even to be able to stand up, right? So that's how to evaluate rear angulation. And I guess I would use the rule of thumb that if you draw your line down here, you want to come, and it's perpendicular to the ground, you want to come to the tip to the front tip of the dog's foot. Okay? That's a good one. Now, rear's a lot easier to evaluate. The front, and what I do is, if you get the GR News, what a wealth of information that is. all those show photographs of the dogs winning. Can you stay hanging on to them? You can draw your lines on them, and you can see, whoa, that judge put up a lot of different things. Or that judge put up everything that looked like the same. Okay? So, two rules of thumb for the front. The first one is, and remember, the dog has to be standing correctly. The first thing you do, that I do, is I put my thumb and index finger on the highest point of that shoulder blade, which for him is right here, okay? Now, you have to kind of build a mental database. You have to get your hands on a lot of dogs. Because here's what you have. Golden Retriever, Labrador Retriever, many other dogs, Poodle, Sheltie. Okay? It's going to be in different places. The further it is forward, the straighter the dog's shoulders are, the more upright the shoulders are. Because what we're looking at is, if this is the point of the shoulder right here. If we draw a perpendicular line through that point of the shoulder, we want the shoulder blades to be back at a 30-degree angle. But most of us don't have a very good mental protractor, right? So that's a little bit harder. So just feel them, and they should be well back. You'll feel differences between dogs. And you'll feel differences between dogs here today. But remember, you've got to have the dog held properly, and head even needs to be a little bit more up like that, okay? The second thing, and this is really easy to measure, is when you feel the highest point of the scapula and that point of the shoulder, you can take a piece of string and put one end of the string here and the other end of the string there, and then swing it down and feel whether it's the same length from that point of the shoulder to the elbow. Can you see how his is a little bit shorter, which I found out today for the first time? Do I have in my... Yes, I do. Hold on. String. Let me show you what I mean. This is it. He's thinking about it. Oh, he's thinking it's good. Okay, so let's go from the point of the shoulder, right here, okay, the highest point of the scapula, and he's got him standing correctly. He must be standing correctly. So we'll go from there to there, and then we're going to swing down, and we're hoping to get to the elbow, which we went past, so his shoulder scapula is longer, okay, so he has a shorter humerus. We want those to be the same length. What's not really true? Right, so we're crossing two joints. I mean, we're crossing two joints. It's not actually, we're not measuring the actual length of the humerus because this point here crosses the shoulder joint, and this point here crosses the elbow joint. But is that not a rule of thumb that you can use?
I would say they're a visual guide of how we see the dog.
Right.
You're actually measuring the ends of those bones that where they join.
Right, so we're not actually measuring
the
length of the bone.
It's not the humerus or the scapula. It's
right.
The appearance of the joint.
Right. Which is why you don't want to do it this way by folding the leg up like that. That will make this part of the leg abnormally long because you've opened this joint up. That's why you have to have the dog standing correctly.
Chris, can I just make a quick comment about dropping from the pin bone through the toes too?
Yeah.
I mean, that is basically partially an indication of, again, the equal bone lengths in the rear. Again, visual appearance of the equal bone lengths rather than
the actual bone lengths.
So if your line falls way, way in front of where the toe is, and the toe's way, way back, means that second thigh is much longer than your femur.
This is longer.
Than your femur, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Than this.
Yeah. So it's again looking
It's just a rule of thumb, though. It doesn't say everything, does it? Because you really have to feel how much bend there is at the
stifle. It's a guideline,
right.
A visual aid.
You should never give a talk in front of two people who don't
know more. No, I'm learning stuff. My God.
Okay, so those are the two rules. You know what I actually do? I'll tell you what my little tip is. When the dog is standing correctly, I just like to draw a line up the, up through the radius and ulna and see if we get so far straight line perpendicular to the ground takes us. Takes us to the withers. I'm good. But if that line is further forward, then I'm then it usually means the dog has a shorter or more upright humerus. So these are just little rules of thumb. It takes you a lifetime to learn structure, and all of us are still learning. And where's my? So we're going to break up into groups and look at that. But I just want to go over a couple of things. What does the rear leg do? The rear leg is in charge of a whole bunch of things. It has, well, we don't know whether it's equal, but probably about equal. When a dog is galloping, it drives the dog forward, right? But so does the front. When a dog is swimming, if the dog uses their rear properly, it also provides some drive forward. It helps with accurate turns, okay? The dog lifts their front up to make a turn, and then pushes with the rear. I did a study comparing Labrador Retrievers and Border Collies in terms of how much weight they put on their fronts and the rear. Most dogs have 60% of their weight on the front and 40% on the rear. Border Collies have much less weight on the front, statistically less weight on the front using objective gait analysis. Probably because turning is a big, big job for them, so they have to offload their front to make the turn, and then the rear drives them in the direction of that turn immediately after making after moving their front. Also, jumping over obstacles, the thing that drives the dog, so the front is what determines how high a dog jumps, the rear is what determines how far a dog jumps, okay? And remember, a dog that's going faster goes further with each jump. When a dog's going slow, they jump with a rounded trajectory. When a dog's going fast, they jump with a flatter trajectory. In many sports, we want them to go fast. And just think about this, when a dog is doing field, it's really a series of jumps that they're doing. Every time a dog gallops, they're pushing off from the rear as if they're going over a low jump, okay? And leaping into the water also is, the rear does that, a great part of that. Now in terms of the front legs, as I said, 60% of the weight is on the front, and that's true for Labs and Goldens. The front determines how high the dog can jump, and it provides horizontal thrust when the dog is galloping, and also initially when the dog is jumping into the water after a retrieve. The front is also important for initiating turns, okay? That initial movement to make a turn is done by the front. All right. And then the other handout that I gave you, which is just to, for your edification, is this. I gave this to you as a separate handout. It's just a list of what the functions are of the front and the rear, and what it means if your dog is, for example, straighter in the rear, or more angulated in the rear, or has an upright shoulder, or has a shorter humerus, or straighter humerus, okay? So that's just a little summary, and you've got it as a full page handout. And the last thing I just want you to remember is that dew claws are a functioning digit. They really are. Every single canid and felid, wild canid and felid has them. If they really weren't very useful, evolution would have gotten rid of them. So they are a functioning digit. They They are on the ground when the dog is galloping because the dog has the whole foot. The carpal pad is down on the ground. And at that point now, this dew claw is in contact with the ground. Also, dogs use them as ice picks for getting out of ice in the wintertime if they fall through the ice or they're retrieving through ice. And I certainly have had, I've known a number of very sad circumstances of dogs drowning because they couldn't get out of ice. And that's not something you want to happen. Okay, so one last thing before we evaluate our dogs. You can change your dog's structure. You can certainly optimize it. Now, the dog has genetically what it was given, but environment, in particular fitness, can change that tremendously. So remember how I said you have to have good muscularity to hold the leg in its angled position. If the dog has not been exercised, they will gradually have muscle atrophy, and then their leg can go into a straighter conformation. If you then exercise the rear, they can go back to the angulation they were genetically meant to have. So if you guys have dogs with a straighter front or a straighter rear, and they don't have optimal fitness, you can change that and improve the angulation. And that's what a lot of people don't know. And I've seen that happen time and time again. If you have a handout, take a look at slide 31. You can see a husky. That husky got a lot of exercise. He was a mushing dog. Got a lot of exercise, but then his owner developed multiple sclerosis, couldn't exercise her dogs anymore. And guess what? In a year, the dog looked like, the same dog looked like the one on the front. It's the same dog. Let me just show you that picture.
Wow.
Isn't that incredible?
Two different dogs.
It's the same dog, very straight angles, but if you exercised the dog on the right, you could make him go back to the dog on the left. Look at how that would change his angles. What I would say is that I think the majority of dogs that I see that are in performance events are not fully fit. Because here's the thing, you can't get your dog optimally fit by just playing the game. By training and competing, you're not going to do it. You have to target the muscles that the dog needs work on.
Cross training, like athletes.
Absolutely. And you have to target, and I will tell you this other thing, if you just want to target one set of muscles, it's the core. A year ago, I was examining 20 dogs in Switzerland. They were the top dogs in agility in the country. Several of them were on their world team. How many of those 20 dogs do you think had fit cores? Two. Out of 20 dogs. Some of the most fit, or certainly the most capable dogs in the country in agility, which is a sport that requires a lot of different muscles. So, core work is the most important thing for you to do with your dogs. And I will show you my favorite core exercise. I'm going to go get some food. Does anybody have food here?
Yeah.
Okay. And I just realized it's in my refrigerator and I don't have my refrigerator turned off. I don't want to open it. Okay. So the best core exercise. My favorite exercise. No, we're not going up there. Come here, sit. Now, I will just tell you, there was a blog that went out about 6 months ago saying you should never, ever, ever, ever do this with your dog. Mm-hmm. It was put out by a PT who's trained in dog physical therapy. And she said the reason you should never, ever, ever do it is because it puts too much pressure on the dog's facet joints and their vertebrae. But I'm here to tell you that there was a publication in 1992 by Butterman et al. That looked at exactly how much pressure is put on the dog's vertebra when you do this, and they showed it was 1/3 the pressure of a dog going upstairs. So it's okay to do this. So if you ever have someone tell you don't ever do this with your dog, they would be wrong. Not until 6 months of age. Okay, that's a good question. We don't do this until a dog's 6 months of age. Now, I have a lot of people who try to do this and they can't get their dog to do it, and it's usually your fault, not the dog's fault. Two things. First of all, First of all, the dog, some dogs you have to try it every day for about a week because they need to build their muscles up. But most of the time it's because we're not holding the food correctly. What we want to do is we want to start with the dog sitting and let them nibble on the food the whole time. I never want to get to the position where I could say beg and my dog does it. I'm never going to teach them that because it takes away a whole bunch of control that I would otherwise have. So I'm going to let the dog nibble on the food and I'm going to rotate the food back until it's over the dog's butt. Now initially the dog might try to hold on. If you do, you can just put your hands like this so he can't grab you. Now, why do I want the dog nibbling the whole time? Because I can move the food back and forth and make him work his muscles even harder, okay? So, look, I'm working the lateral muscles, I'm working the cranial and the dorsal abdominal muscles. And then the other thing that I can do is, while he's chewing on this, I can push on him. I can offload him. Come here, sit. Hey, no standing up. If the dog stands up, you pull the food away and you're like, sorry, buddy, it's not part of the rules. Because standing up's a lot easier, okay? So, you want to try again? And then you can push on him. You can pull on his ears. You can tell him he's a good boy. You can rock him like this. And he has to stay on that pattern. You can tap his toes. You can tap these. I mean, you can do everything you want to pull him out of position. And you want the dog to do 3 15-second begs with a little 5-second break in between. You can actually have a bite. Okay. So, we're gonna have you try that with your dogs as well. Yes.
I was wondering how familiar you were with the foot pause training. And
yes, I'm very familiar with foot pause training.
Yeah, and what is your opinion of what they
It's
offer?
Too big a question to answer what my opinion is of it, but I would say to you, just for starters, I would not use any of that stuff. It's for more advanced dogs. This exercise itself, can you see how he's panting? Panting for the first time. That means he has been working, right? He's got blood circulating. He's panting to add more oxygen to the blood. The biggest mistake I see with people using physio balls and things like that is using them on dogs that are not ready for it. This exercise in and of itself doesn't require any equipment and has tremendous effects, benefits. Once your dog, and I'll just tell you the next couple of steps, once your dog can do it like this, for no matter how much you perturb his balance, on a nice solid surface, then you can do it on a bed or an ottoman, in other words, a soft, level surface. Once he can do 3 15-second begs on a soft, level surface, you can do it on hills, facing each of the four directions. Once a dog can do it on hills, Then you can do it on an egg-shaped physio ball, as you can see in slide 36, okay? Where he's doing it on an egg-shaped physio ball that's not very fully blown up. It's got a lot of sag to it, okay?
Sit. I have a question.
Stay. Hold on a second. I'm just going to have the camera look at this. So that's only for the very advanced dogs. You do not want to advance until the dog can do 3 15-second begs with all of those perturbations because he's not ready for it. If you want, usually it takes about 6 months to get to the point where Hobby just demonstrated, and then it usually takes another 6 months of doing it twice a week, which is how often you should do it, another 6 months till you get to doing the egg-shaped physio ball. So it's really a lifetime exercise that takes a long, long time for your dog to progress, and that's what you want. Okay? Don't put your dogs on these balls early on. It's way too stressful for their bodies most of the time if they're not ready for it. And someone else had a question.
I had a question.
Yes.
If you do it when you progress the part where you're doing it like on a hill,
yes.
Do you do one session is one direction or do you do
yes.
all four
one
directions?
One session today I would only face uphill.
Okay.
And I'm only ever doing 3 15-second
right.
begs. This takes less than a minute to
right.
do this exercise. How great is that?
Yeah.
You don't have to go running for 3 miles on a pavement road with your dog to try and build their muscles. In fact, Hobby. In fact, one of the things that I see is people doing way too much in the way of trotting their dogs, like with golf carts and bicycles and stuff like that. That is an endurance exercise. It's not what most of our dogs need. If you have a mushing dog or a field trial dog or a herding dog, yes. But most of the time our dogs need these stationary exercises that target specific musculature. Okay? Any questions before we break up into groups and try it? Yes. There's two reasons for the roll that I can think of. One is they're too fat.
Right.
The other would be that they don't have strong back muscles. And in that case, the bag is a great solution for that, knowing that it takes a while to work up to that. Any other questions? That was the question was, what about a dog that rolls when they trot? Okay.
What about the pacing?
This is a... It's a long, long story. Who asked that? Was it you? I'm gonna say very, very briefly. Most of the time, when we say that a dog is pacing, they're actually doing a fast walk, which is an amble, which is a normal gait for tired dogs or lazy dogs. The pace, there's only ever 2 feet on the ground, and then there's a moment of suspension, and then the other 2 feet are on the ground. We don't see that nearly as often as we see dogs ambling. And an amble is just a dog that's walking fast like this. It looks like both legs on the same side are moving forward together, but actually there are times when there are 3 feet on the ground. And that's just a fast walk. So I feel you have to differentiate between those two gaits. And the real difference is that in a pace, there's only ever 2 feet on the ground. In an amble, there alternates 2 and 3 feet on the ground. If I had a chance to show you videos, I would, but we don't have that capability here. Come to one of my seminars, or I'm going to be starting in about 3 months. I'll be having a lot of this stuff online that you can come and look at. So I'm just in the process of putting that stuff up now. Keep him out, Deb. Don't put him away yet. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. You can shut the video live off. Thank you very much, everybody on Facebook.